take a lot of time, and this particular graph biomass is shown to be a considerable part of their total portfolio. Message number one from all those scenarios is we need everything we got to meet the future energy demand. We're looking at least a doubling of energy demand in the first half of this century, and it may be more. We cannot exclude any option from that perspective. Very important is that we will need a large amount of liquid and gaseous energy carriers. That is a fact. Despite electric vehicles, many sectors do need that. Biomass is the only option that we have available to provide the carbon neutral carbon. So that's message number one. On the bottom, you see the maybe a bit cryptical summary of the fourth assessment report of the IPCC on mitigation of climate change. And that is a summary of all the mitigation potentials in energy supply, in transport, buildings, industry, agriculture, forestry, and waste. The good news from this report, that was published in 2007, is that principally we have enough mitigation options to meet our target. So that's a piece of good news. The complex message is, again, we need everything we got. It is a whole mixture of options. And if you look at this combination, bioenergy is part of about any sector. It's in energy supply, power and heat production, biofuels. It's in feedstock for industry. It's, of course, in agriculture, forestry, and even the waste sector, where we have the biogenic element of the waste flows. So bioenergy is intertwined with this total mitigation potential. But if you take it away, we will miss out on a large part of that potential, and the equation does not match. So here is a key graph. Although it is a little bit of an old analysis, that gives a bit more insight in what we are looking at globally as the factors driving land use change, and largely also unsustainable land use change. Land use change here is depicted in terms of carbon lost. So this is especially forest cover loss, transformation of natural grasslands, etc. And you see a breakdown of the factors that have driven that for decades. And biofuels are there. It's a small arrow, so it does play a role according to this analysis. There's conventional agriculture, but two-thirds of the drivers, as indicated by this FAO analysis, are poverty-related. The biggest one is subsistence farming, and one below there is fuel wood. About two-thirds of that have to do with issues around development, about people that have to survive, rely on the land, but don't have the means to produce more efficiently. Knowing this as a key fact, but why do we see the forest going down? Why do we see ever-expanding land use? And apparently this is one of the most important factors. It becomes very important to include that in the whole debate, clearly. So here is a result of an analysis that is also nicely summarized in the big green book that you can all get for free outside. That makes a very nice summary about the Brazilian ethanol industry. And it is a global analysis about the possibilities we have, in principle, to increase efficiency in agriculture. And at the moment we would do that, it could free up land. I will not go into all the details, but the basic message of this analysis is that we have so much improvement potential in agricultural management and also the management of our livestock that we can decrease our footprint of food production considerably during this century. In the utmost theoretical case, and I have to stress that this is a theoretical case, we can even decrease our land use that we use today for food, which is about 5,000 million hectares globally, to one-fifth of that amount, really one-fifth of that amount. At the moment, we deploy everything we got. That will not look very pretty, and it will not be realistic that we do that, but it makes very, very clear how large that potential really is. If we only were able to use a fraction of that theoretical potential, we can keep our land use under control. This message is not new. It has been confirmed earlier that the world may be able to feed 45 billion people. This is an old statement that also is based on FAO analysis. So we don't principally have a shortage of capabilities to produce. It is a matter of how we do that. So that's also a piece of very basic knowledge. But then the question is, what pathway are we going to choose? And this is IPCC terminology of the different worlds we may be heading. A2 is a very unpleasant future in which we basically are not successful in deploying key policies around climate change and working together between the North and the South, closing kind of the wealth gap, if you want. But there's also other possible pathways, like globally oriented, a conscious world, in which there's, for example, a climate treaty that will be very effective. There is rapid technological developments, etc. So there are contrasting possibilities still. And they will have very different impacts on climate change, on the energy system, but also on land use. And we have modeling tools that kind of show what kind of trends we may be looking at in terms of different patterns. So I'm not going into the details, but this shows that this is principally possible. And if you see what those type of models have told us in the past already, what this can do to land use, and here you're looking at a summation of different land use categories for this A2, this very unpleasant future scenario, you see that cropland, which is the red category, will just keep on increasing during the century. And it will especially go at the expense of the green category, which is forest. There will be abandoned land, but it is very likely that it's going to be damaged, degraded because of poor management. In contrast, there is the A1 scenario, which is assuming very rapid economic development, but also very rapid technological progress, for example, in agriculture. The net result is that land use for agriculture may start to shrink after the medium term, and it may end up by the end of the century to a land surface that may be half that we see today. That is basically utilizing a part of those yield gaps that I've briefly talked about. And the amount of abandoned land, as it is defined here, may also include fairly good quality land that is just not needed to meet food demands anymore. Key message is, we have choices. We have choices to make in how we manage our agricultural system and also thus what is our footprint for food production. So if we then assume that we have land available, whether it's marginal, degraded, or good quality land, it is a matter of choice what we do with that. And here is a very crude summary of how much biofuels as a measure of efficiency you may produce per hectare in net energy terms, so subtracting the inputs from key food crops that we are used today, wheat, corn, but also sugarcane is here. And then here down are perennial crops, trees, grasses, etc. And what you do see today is that sugarcane and even also palm oil are clear winners in terms of net energy yield per hectare. But if you look at the perennials, like willows in a temperate climate, it could be eucalyptus in a more tropical climate, they still are able to do better than that. So it may be on average, especially in the temperate climates, about 3 times more net energy yield per hectare, assuming that we have the capability to convert lignocellulose to liquid fuel. And very important is the last row, that perennials are capable to be established on marginal degraded lands. Food crops are not, typically not. They will get a lower yield because of the poorer conditions, but they still get a reasonable output per hectare. And that means that your land base you can look at for biomass production with perennials is completely different than when you focus on the annual crops alone. In total, you're looking at an order of magnitude difference compared to the current first-generation biofuels like the corn and the rapeseed also in Europe. I will come back to the position of sugarcane hopefully at the end of this. Well, we have translated those IPCC scenarios into energy potentials. Here on the y-axis you see exajoules of energy. And for comparison, you can say at the moment we use almost 500 exajoules of primary energy today worldwide. So that's the sum of coal, oil, gas, etc., 500. And what you see is that the A2 clearly results in the lowest energy potential. This, for example, assumes that we have some residues, and also we use marginal degraded lands for perennial crop production. But it is definitely constrained up to something like 100 exajoules. So that is limited, about 1/5 of current primary energy demand. Not small, but it is limited. But at the moment you see what the effect is of going up in the efficiency ladder in agriculture up to the best scenarios, which are A1 and B2, very close, it may get up to over 300 exajoules from energy crops alone. So that is very, very sizable. And then we have to look at cost. And at the moment you consider perennial crops, trees, grasses, etc., and you look at the characteristics that determine cost, like yield and land prices and inputs, etc., you can also produce an overall global cost supply curve related to those scenarios. This is still an important analysis that was published very recently in scientific literature. And you see that that cost supply curve, here again are the exajoules on the x-axis, up to 200, up to 300 exajoules for some of the scenarios. The largest part of that potential is between $1 and $2 per gigajoule. Those are dollars of 2,000, so it's roughly equal to euros per gigajoule. And then keep in mind what the price of coal is today. That is about 1.5 euro per gigajoule. So you're looking at a large potential of biomass production in the world that could be at a similar cost as the cheapest fossil fuel we have today, being coal, with perennial crops. So the economic potential is also there. Oh, wait a second. And then, of course, we had the key debate on, okay, you can talk about those potentials, but what about water? What about biodiversity? What about land quality? Of course, those concerns are very real. By no means I want to underplay those. But the modeling is definitely already sophisticated, so you can say that many of the answers are already available. It's not perfect, but it is definitely good quality. So we use those overlays, if you want, on, for example, water scarcity in 2050, including climate change, including increased demand for water. We looked at land qualities, including heavy degradation, and also at our ambitions to protect biodiversity worldwide, so increasing the number of nature reserves, for example. So those overlays were included. I can talk for hours on this, but of course I don't have the time for that. But if you're willing to believe me, we came to an integrated picture last year, combining this information, starting from the sustainability debate as it has been raised over the last year, with a breakdown of, let's say, the potential globally of biomass among different categories, including those key constraints. And there is a basis in residues and waste that is very important for power and heat, but also for second generation biofuels that is sizable. Then looking at a base scenario, which is kind of in the middle between A2 and A1, we're looking at a total potential summing up to 250 exajoule. If you include the degraded and marginal lands, it goes in the direction of 300. And at the moment, we are more progressive, so moving to that kind of A1, B1 management, if I have defined it, we may be able to achieve a bioenergy production potential of about 400 exajoules compared to that range in the future world's energy demand. So the overall picture remains, based on this analysis, that bioenergy can be developed to a sustainable option, taking into account the key constraints, food demand, water, biodiversity, land quality, up to one-third of the global energy demand. I still defend that option very much. So the key factors that we have to take into account, though, are plentiful. It is not a given that we have this potential. And first and foremost, that is the agricultural management, because if we fail to improve that fast enough, that potential will largely not be there. That is a very important message. It is also in the choice of the crops. Putting sugarcane apart for the moment, the future is not in annual food crops as the key feedstock. It is also, of course, about are we able to use the degraded lands. We have to take a look at water efficiency. That can principally be done, but we have to include it in the whole equation. And there is many development dimensions here. So the potentials could in fact be large, up to that one-third. That is kind of the niche, if you want to call it a niche, bioenergy could fill. But this cannot be separated from the overall development pathway of land use efficiency. Investment in agriculture and livestock is essential. Some people call it the second green revolution, and we basically need that already to secure our food supplies. That is feasible, technically and economically, and it can also be combined with increased water use efficiency, lower land use, better protection of soils, and also, especially, better incomes, more profitable farming. And that is essential for food security as such. We know that. FAO last year has made those statements on agriculture as such. But the question is, who's going to solve that? For 3 to 4 decades, we have not been able to crack that nut for agriculture alone. But bioenergy, because of its size, of the potential, and the economic impact it could have, can be the key lever to bring that movement into the rural regions. The $3 trillion we are spending on oil imports in the industrialized countries can basically be shifted from the Arabian deserts to the rural regions in the developing countries. And that's a fundamental difference. So that is the key link I want to stress. Then governance of that, of course, is the key. I have a few more slides to make. This is what it may look like around 2040, 2050. A global market, because you need that to link the supply with the demand. Key producing regions, Latin America, Sub-Saharan Africa, Eastern Europe also is very important. Those are the regions that could produce a net surplus of bioenergy compared to that world average that could become structural exporters. The red figures, by the way, are millions of hectares. The millions of hectares needed to meet at 200 to 300 exajoule of production capacity. The red lines are the key trade flows, and the dark green lines are the regions that could also supply the residues. This is what it looks like. It could be a marvelous picture, but it could also get out of hand, so we have to govern this. IEA, in the meantime, has said, this is the future, if you want. The future will be for second-generation biofuels. Look what they dare to say in 2008. They have not done this for years, but it was